is Todd Yoder, and you're talking sports with Randy Harris.
Coming to you live from Tournament de Pizza. What's the special today? Whatever Caleb and Ronnie and friends want.
Whatever I don't have to cook. Because I'm on a.
You're gonna give us some stuff that's been in the freezer.
I'm gonna defrost some stuff.
Yeah, right.
I'm gonna do Uber Eats for you. Like,
he's like, "What do you guys want?
What do you like?" I'm like you guys. I'm ready to start my new career. The one career that is never a job.
Can hardly wait to hear what this is.
I'm walking onto his practice team this year. I'm gonna be a starting QB.
You have a practice team, Caleb?
Listen,
you have your own practice.
Yeah, exactly.
We're going to the league.
The careers he's. Something about being an actor. He wants to get a show, the one-man show, the two-man show.
I'm already naked. I'm great at it.
You know what I'm saying? And he's doing football. He's got a lot going on right now.
But I want to act like I'm a football player.
Can act like any of those things.
I'll never work a day in my life.
All right, let's head back MMA-wise. Yep. A lot of stuff still to talk about with Ronnie and some other things. But did you get to watch The Ultimate Fighter yesterday?
I did not. I was so exhausted from workouts and Pilates that I did not get to watch it. But I will catch up.
And I was watching Godfather, so I was doing research.
Yeah, sure.
I didn't have time to catch The Ultimate Fighter. I'm sorry.
I think this is the first time. You know, I've been covering The Ultimate Fighter since number one.
Yeah.
And we used to have a guy on. We became very good friends. He went on to be the welterweight champion. He went on to be the pound-for-pound champion in Kamaru Usman.
Yeah.
Now we're honored to have his brother on, who's on the show, and he was victorious in yesterday's episode. Let's welcome to the program, Muhammad Usman. Mo, how are you?
I'm doing good. Thank you guys for having me.
We appreciate your time, but start with, where are we in the filming? I know the filming is all done, and we're only going to talk up through yesterday's episode. How many days have you now been in the house?
I was in the house roughly 6 weeks. And I'm back home now. The filming is ended. So we're just kind of sitting back watching everything we've done.
So I'm saying the episode that we saw yesterday, it was the third episode. How many days up through that filming? I think we were told, Caitlin said it was like 10 days or 6 days up to her fight. So where are we in the days?
It's the exact same.
Okay.
Literally about 10 days into the house, I fought him. I fought Mitchell C.
What was the first thing that you did when you got into the house? Everybody has told us location of the rooms, who the roommate is. Was that the same with you?
Yeah, the first thing that I did is, of course, go find my room. And then I kind of started organizing my things to get everything exactly where I was going to have them for 6 weeks.
We're going to continue talking about yesterday's episode, but I want to bring this into something else, and you'll find out in a second. How old were you when you moved and the family moved from Nigeria to Texas?
When we moved to Texas, I was 7 years old.
Seven. And where in Nigeria are you from?
I'm from Awuchi. So it's kind of like Awuchi. Or we're from Awuchi Village, so you can just say Benin City.
Okay. My co-host, who plays for the New Orleans Saints, I'm curious, Caleb, I'm sure you've told me, but how old were you when you moved from Nigeria?
I was 9 years old, and I was born in Lagos, but my dad is from Benin City, and so my family is from Benin City as well.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. That's dope. I actually have a clothing brand I'd love to send for you and your brother, Kamaru. It's called Abuja Bodega. So if you can get me an address, I would love to send you guys some hoodies and crew necks and T-shirts and stuff like that so you can check it out.
Okay, yeah, sounds great, man. I think I kind of gave the address already. So, yeah, you should have all that already.
We'll take care of that. Now, let me ask you this. Caleb says he's going to take us. Of course, we're waiting.
Yeah.
He says he's going to take us to a Nigerian restaurant. So I need to ask you, what do I want to eat and what do I definitely want to stay away from?
I think that's kind of a hard one because I go to Nigerian restaurants and I eat like a rice and stew with like a meat. I don't really get into the soups in Nigerian restaurants because my mom isn't cooking it. I don't want
to feel you. Yeah. I feel that.
Muhammad, do they have buffets in Nigeria? Because Randy is a buffet master. I mean, if there was one thing he's great at, it is buffets.
Listen, I'm going to order for you. I'm going to get you some jollof rice, some egusi soup, some suya, You know, I'm gonna lace you right. You're gonna be full when you leave.
Let me tell you this, Mo, and since Matt just threw me under the bus, when I'm just on before anybody in this room was born, you know, it was one event like every 6 months. Now that they're almost every week, I look at who's on the card, what city it's in, and what's the best restaurant in that town.
Oh man, that's awesome. Actually, honestly, I love that. Like even with my brother, whenever he fights, and we'll go to these different places. Like we've been in Brazil, we've been all over the world, and that's the number one thing, honestly, that I love is their culture, their food. So that's our first thing that we do as well. We try to see exactly what type of food they have there.
When you get a chance, ask Dr. Davidson. I'm sure you know who Jeff Davidson is, the head medical at the UFC. Ask him about our experiences in Rio. I won't talk about them all on the air, but it involves police and guns.
Oh, no, for sure. I'll definitely ask him when I see him.
Mo, switching gears a little bit, I want to talk to you about this. So, you know, your brother has had, you know, a ton of success.
Yeah, he's okay.
Yeah, you know, he's doing all right for himself in the UFC, you know. Lots of accolades. Going into the house, going into Ultimate Fighter, did you feel pressure to live up to expectations of the name? Did you feel like people had a target on you, kind of like, hey, I can say I beat Kamaru's brother and things like that? What was that dynamic like when you came in, and kind of how did you navigate those, you know, emotions?
Yeah, coming into the house, I had to kind of put my mind in the state of mind for everything you just said. I knew I was going to have a target on my back based on who my brother was, because it's just like, yeah, I want to be the Usman, you know, like I was telling, like we were talking about, like, it's almost like their Super Bowl, you know, they want to bring their A game. They want to come, you know, with everything they have. And I respect that, because that can only make me better, you know, if I channel it the right way. So my number one thing was just to really block it out and just focus on myself. Focus on putting myself on a schedule. Focus on making sure I got everything out of myself, eating, recovery, sleeping. I really kind of focused on blocking everything out and just concentrating on my goal, because they definitely had a target on my back, as you can see from day one. Mitchell just was already ready to come at me with everything.
We'll touch base on that in a second, but I need to ask you. I reached out to Kamaru, and he didn't respond. He's probably busy doing much more important things than talking to me. So I want to ask you, what was it like growing up? What kind of games did you play in the backyard, on the street? You know, we all played these games. What did you guys do as a family?
We did basically what every, you know, American household, you know, kids do. We played video games, basketball, all types of sports, but like the number one thing with us is I remember we used to clean. So my mom, we made it into a cleaning game. So basically, we would have one person would do the dishes, the other person would sweep and do the top and the floors, and then my other brother always was off. So whoever was off that day would just sit there and talk crap to us while we're cleaning. And sometimes I would want to trade in. I'd be like, listen, if you clean today, I'll clean, you know, 3 days later, you know. And so we used to always turn cleaning into a game. And it's crazy, as I've gotten older now, I really took that. It's crazy when you think when you're kids, you understand how you can honestly take something and it applies to your grown-up life. But now it's like I love cleaning.
Can I get you to my house tonight at 6 o'clock?
speaking of trash talk.
Yeah, no, for sure. That's how we were raised.
So Mo, speaking of trash talking, we know your brother fought Covington, probably the greatest trash talker of all of them. But this past weekend, we saw the corner man, Tony Kelly, in Andrew Lee's corner talk about the dirty Brazilians and dropping the explosives. Is there a line in trash talking, and did the corner go too far? Is this something that's not acceptable with the fighters as far as etiquette?
Before you answer, Mo, and I'm just going to throw it out and then we'll talk about it, how many times did you and I talk about this in the locker room?
Yeah, a lot.
Numerous times. So go ahead, Muhammad, give me your view.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, when somebody's trash talking, they're basically doing it. They're already doing it. So there's no end of the earth somebody can go to that's trash talking. That, let me just get that clear. There's no end of the earth. But if you ask me if there is a limit you can't cross, I totally agree. you know, because as much as you're trash talking and you're trying to get something out of this, your opponent, or, you know, and or make something come across to them to hurt their feelings or whatever, there's just that limit that, you know, you just cannot cross, you know, where it gets to when it comes from trash talk to hate.
You got something?
Yeah, I mean, I agree, but also
I disagree.
So look, I agree in a sense that there, you can cross that point, but when you cross that point, as men, we all know there's repercussions and consequences.
Sure. And that's what happened in Miami.
Exactly. So that's all it is. Like, you can say whatever you want to say, but when you get to a certain point, then I'm going to handle it how I see fit to handle it. So, like, it's one of those things where it's like, there isn't really, like, you can go trash talk all day, but there is something that you could say that's going to trigger any man, and now he's going to react how he reacts, and you have to be okay with those consequences.
Mo, how did you stay so focused with everything that they showed? I'm sure a lot happened in the house that they didn't show. How did you stay so focused and calm in the house and then leading up to the fight?
Oh, man. Honestly, truthfully speaking, I did a lot of cold tubs. I would, every day, every night, I would order at least 10 to 15 bags of ice. And I tried to get in there. If not every night, every other night. And they didn't show that, you know. But yeah, I did a lot of ice baths. I would just sit in there for about 10 to 15 minutes, you know, at nighttime before I took a shower and went to sleep. And that really, I know it sounds crazy, but it really helped me focus. It helped me calm my mind, because you know how cold it is when you get in that freezing ice bath. Your mind goes; it has to go to a calm state. Because you're going to just be in there yelling because it's so cold. So your mind would just really calm down, and I would just put myself in the moment of the fight and visualize it and then just go to sleep. It was a tricky one, but it really brought the best out of me. You know, I really just had to master being in that house with all these different people that I don't know. And the number one thing that helped me was just concentrating on myself 100%.
Going through the Ultimate Fighter, I kind of equate it to the draft process for myself. You know, it's long hours, not a lot of sleep, a lot of hard work, a lot of focus. Like, who have you leaned on the most? Is it your coach? Is it Kamaru? Or are you trying to kind of pave your own way and be like, hey, like, I'm going to handle this, big bro? And, you know, like, how, like, what's your process like in that aspect? Because I know for me, going through the combine and the draft, like, I had my agent and different kind of stuff like that. You know, but I still also had to go sit down and kind of figure out what kind of player do I want to be when I get to the NFL and those kind of things. So how are you kind of approaching that process?
I approached it. Of course, I took advice from everybody. You know, at the end of the day, these are people that, you know, that have done it or have seen it happen that I'm taking advice from, as my brother, Rashad Evans, all my coaches. And then even when I got in the house, a lot of my, even my teammates, they were very encouraging. And I just approached it and took from them. The number one thing I just took from all of them is focus on yourself and get the best out of this opportunity. And don't let nothing distract you. You know, don't let nothing come into this space of focus that I have right now, this bubble of focus. Do not let anything distract me or penetrate my focus. And I feel like once they made that into me going into the house, it couldn't be broken. Every time anything would happen, like, don't he got me to always take myself back into that state of just locking mind into the present moment and focus.
Yeah.
Mahan, I want to say this, you know, to you, just as a fan of media, of covering this sport as long as I have, I respected so much what I saw last night, and we talk about this all the time. I was going to use bigger words like, you know, hated and whatever. I hate when somebody's talking crap, one or both, they fight, then they hug, then they go train together. I hate that. I liked how you handled yourself. I liked how, you know, the fight was over. You turned around to celebrate with your team and wanted no part of Mitch. You didn't want to congratulate him. You didn't want to bond with him. And I thought that showed more genuine than I respected him because of the fight and now we're cool.
Oh, no, yeah, totally, because it was more than just trash talking. Don't get me wrong. We shared a moment in that cage where it was, we know what we both did in there. You know, we both came in there and we settled it in the cage. So, but when it comes to wanting to shake my hand and do all this and that, no, it's, I wasn't being rude. I was just so focused and concentrated on these people that helped me get over this obstacle, which was him, and just focused on, I just climbed this hill. And I did not want to shake this man's hand or what. I wanted to celebrate with Juliana, Coach Mike, you know, all my coaches, because they helped me get over this hill. And then you can even see it. Like, after that, when he seen that I was focused on my coaches and my team and the people that helped me, he even turned around and started trying to jaw and say, right, no, I'm going to catch you at the house or do this. I'm like, that's how you knew it wasn't genuine. If you genuinely wanted to shake somebody's hand, even if they didn't shake your hand, you wouldn't turn around and was like, okay, let me catch you outside there.
So all good.
So you just knew that it wasn't organic. And that's, like I said, when I came into the house, anything that I was going to do at this point, I needed it to be free flowing and organic. So I didn't even think about that very moment. All I was thinking about was, wow, I'm just so excited that I just won. Let me celebrate with my coaches. Let me, you know, be happy for this moment. Not, oh, let me shake your hand, Mitchell, for saying all these things. And now you lost and you want me to shake your hand. You know, I felt like that wasn't genuine, and that's why I went about it how I did.
And I enjoyed watching that. Muhammad, thank you very much for your time, for coming on the show. I know we have your address. We're going to send you a care package from 8 Man Strong. We're going to send you a care package from Odd Sock Official, some of the coolest socks out there. And Caleb's going to send you a care package of his clothing line as well for coming on today.
Oh, man, I'm very excited. I can't wait. You know we're rocking, man. You know where we're from.
Sir, I appreciate that. Okay.
You need to come to town. You can go with us to this Nigerian restaurant.
You know where we are from, brother. So don't worry.
I'm right now.
He's Jamaican. That's
all right, Mo, we'll talk to you again really, really soon. That is Muhammad Usman, victorious in today's episode. All right, take care. Okay. All right, let's go hit a quick break. When we come back, we'll jump back out to the UFC and welcome the Ugly Man. He's up next. This is Knockout Radio, brought to you by 8 Man Strong and Staff. So we'll be right back.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
This is Chuck Knoll, and you're talking sports with Randy Harris.
8 Man Strong is not simply about the biggest or strongest. It's about those who have survived true lows, suffered, faced demons real or in their heads, and are fighting to come back against it all. If you live with a passion for greatness and strength and resilience towards all obstacles that may attempt to derail you, if you are bold and aggressive in the pursuit of the things you want in life, if you are meant to overcome everything that stands in your path of reaching your goals, then you are 8 Man Strong.
Friday, March 11th, two of MMA's biggest names battle it out in Eagle FC 46. Kevin the Motown Phenom Lee faces Diego Nightmare Sanchez in a fight everyone will be talking about. And guess who's back? Check out the Taz Mexican Devil Ray Borg as he returns to the cage. It's a big night you don't want to miss. The UFC heavyweight title on the line as Rizvan Kuniev takes on Anthony Hamilton. Eagle FC 46, Friday, March 11th at 6 p.m. Eastern. Watch live and free.
This is Randy Harris for Mick for Hair at Gottsplit and Salon in Pinellas Park, our official hair care and grooming provider who caters to everyone, women, men, kids, and senior citizens in an affordable, upscale environment staffed with the most talented professionals in the business. Visit Mick for Hair at Gottsplit Ends today at 4376 Park Boulevard in Pinellas Park, or call them at 727-290-9873.
You're hungry, where do you go to eat?
Berg Sports Bar and Grill.
You want to have a drink, where do you go?
Berg Sports Bar and Grill.
Having a get-together with the guys from the softball team, where do you do it?
That's right, Berg Sports Bar and Grill.
Located at 1320 Central Avenue, St. Petersburg, right across from Tropicana Field, Berg's is the best place to take the whole family for food and fun. Going to a Rays game? Have dinner before the game at Berg's, and after the Rays win, come and celebrate with all your friends at Berg's, right across from the Trop. So come down and see Berg and the whole gang at Berg Sports Bar and Grill.
Ferg Sports Bar and Grill.
Does your garage door opener seem to have a mind of its own? Or is it a squeaky or noisy garage doors? Sounds like they need a simple tune-up. Call Moores Boulevard Garage Doors. That's M-O-R-S-E Boulevard Garage Doors at 727-522-5070. I'm so glad I did, and they fixed my garage door correctly on the very first visit. Moores Boulevard Garage Doors offers 24/7 service and no extra charge for nights or weekend emergency calls. repair, or replace your garage door with Moores Boulevard Garage Doors, call them today at 727-522-5070.
Construction companies always face hiring challenges. Do you need temporary help on your project? Or maybe you want a true partner for all of your staffing needs? StaffZone is construction staffing excellence, providing both skilled and general labor positions. And we want to work for you. For all of your construction staffing needs, call us at 877-247-ZONE or visit us online at thestaffzone.com to find your local branch. Our staffing professionals are eager and ready to earn your business. That's 877-247-ZONE.
This is the Tantalk Radio Network.
Hey, this is Erasmus James, and you're talking sports with Randy.
Let me just throw out about your nickname, because we've got the Naked Pizza Man sitting here. Sure. And then, Ronnie, you're doing a naked thing on stage on Saturday, so I appreciate getting the naked out and just talking about ugly.
Oh, fully clothed.
You have the Naked Pizza Man on?
Yeah, that's...
Hold on a second. Hold on. Of everything I said, you're going to go right to the Naked Pizza Man. His head is going to now explode.
I'm kind of a big deal.
Look at the way he's sitting.
I'm kind of a big deal. I don't have a throne to sit on like you
he's
do.
He's actually naked right now.
Yeah, Ronnie, right.
This is awkward.
I need your throne. We need to
sit. Oh, man.
So tell us about the nickname so that we don't have to talk about the naked portion of these two guys.
Gotcha. No, Ugly Man Joe just comes from a group I created when I was in college. It was just a way I and my friends were expressing ourselves at the time. Like whenever you'd see a friend, you would start roasting them, you know, talking about how they look, giving them an opportunity to defend themselves, show their confidence. And that's just something that carried on to what I'm doing now. Like, people will see me and, you know, they may think I look a certain way, but at the end of the day, it's the only thing that matters to me is how I feel about myself. So that's kind of where that name comes from.
Very cool. No, I like it. So talk to us about, obviously, this is just the start of Fight Week. Today's all the media stuff, and then you start getting ready for Saturday. What's Fight Week like for you?
This Fight Week has been pretty amazing. I've been less than 10 pounds out, so I don't know if you know, but 10 pounds is nothing to us MMA fighters. Most of the time, guys are cutting around, you know, 15 to 20 pounds this week, so I'm in an incredibly awesome spot this week. So I'm able to eat, kind of enjoy myself, be in good spirits. Most people are normally cranky around this time. So I'm feeling great, man. Super excited to fight.
I remember Johnny Hendricks was on one Wednesday. Obviously, you know, weigh-ins are on Friday, 2 days later. He was only 26 over. So he had 48 hours to lose 26 pounds. And the thing that blows my mind, and obviously you know and most people know, he did it.
Yeah, they're going to do it. It's going to suck, but they're going to do it.
Well, in that case, how come the champion, Charles Oliveira, couldn't lose half a pound to keep his championship belt at the last UFC fight?
Tampering.
It was probably around the same situation. He probably had, you know, more than 18 pounds, I would say, fight week, and he's trying to scramble and do it at the last minute, and that's just not the healthiest way. And sometimes you get down to those point of a pound, and if it – by then, it already takes you 30 minutes in the sauna to even start sweating. You know, so normally when you're kind of like where I am now, I can sweat in under 3 minutes. I can start a run and start sweating right away just because I ran most of my weight off. I didn't, you know, start depriving myself of water and doing the things you have to do at the last minute. I did the right thing where I'm outside, you know, in the sun working out, and I'm still drinking a gallon of water. So I have plenty of water inside of me still to get rid of at the last minute. So these last 2 days are really more relaxing for me, and I'll go in sauna tomorrow night and sauna right before the weigh-ins, and it'll just shed right off.
Have you ever tried steam room? That's what a lot of guys in the league use when they're trying to drop weight before Thursday weigh-ins. So you see, on Thursday, everybody usually, let's say we have meetings at 8 o'clock, 5:30, the locker room is full of the big dudes, and they're sitting in that steam room trying to sweat off those last few pounds.
Now that's another vision I can't get out of my mind. So the two guys to my left are talking about being naked, and now Caleb is talking about all these big old linemen in a sweat room
One guy's actually naked.
You know what's crazy? None of them are naked because they're trying to sweat. So they're going in
right,
there with
the
long
bags.
Sleeves and their, you know, pool shorts, and yeah, they're trying to get
some pounds off. So here's the thing about the steam rooms. So what happens is you're losing weight initially at the moment. You're losing water weight, sweat, whatever. As soon as you drink water, so if the guys are sitting in the sauna drinking water to hydrate as they're sweating,
they're
staying the same.
No, they're not.
They cut the water, but what makes a sauna work isn't weight loss. What makes the sauna work is it raises your core body temperature, and that is thermogenic, and that's what makes you metabolize and burn more fat. So it's the heating of your body temperature from the inside, from the core.
Yeah.
This is what thermogenics are.
Joe, I was going to ask you, how are you going to pass the time this week? But I'm going to change it to, how can you help me pass the time when Matt talks?
You can get a pen and you can tap it on the table until he's done.
listen, Ryan Bader has a liner where he calls Randy the ugly man.
He does.
And it's one of the greatest liners we have. And he goes like, you're listening to Randy Harris, the ugly Randy Harris. Or the ugly man.
Yeah, so, something like that. What's the strangest thing that's ever happened, Joe, in the middle of a fight, either to you, involving the fight, anything that comes to mind?
Man, I don't know if it'd be strange, but one recent fight, I got hit really, really bad in the private area. But
yeah, that's not strange. That's painful.
Really strange. Man, I honestly, strange things don't really happen. My fights don't last super long, and then when they do, they're like super serious. So weird stuff's not really happening.
The one that I remember the most, Ron, I was interviewing a fighter that fought a German. I don't remember who it was. And he said that he heard the corner talking German. So he said for like 6, 8, 10 seconds, his mind went blank and he's watching the movie Inglourious Basterds in the middle of a fist fight. And it took him like 10 seconds to kind of break out of watching the movie. That's why I always ask that.
Bad timing. No, that's the worst timing to start watching a movie.
To start the daydream. Are you a fan of other sports, and what do you do to either watch or relax when you're not trying to think that you're going to be in a fist fight in a couple days?
I'm a fan of football. Patrick Mahomes is my favorite guy. Kansas City Chiefs. Go Chiefs!
But talk to Marquez about that.
Marquez is actually an awesome guy too. He's fighting Austin right after I am, so go Julian, praying for you. But I mean, during fight week, I really just relax with my girl. I got my Xbox here. I try and jump on games when I can, but I'm mainly just really sitting down, just in my mind, visualizing success and just picturing every way the fight could possibly go, to be honest. Some people, that might be kind of tedious, but for me, it's a little bit more relaxing to kind of picture the fight, because once I'm in the fight, it seems a little bit more, I don't know, familiar.
Sure. I did something for Julian when he came to one of the UFCs. It was two ago, I think, in Jacksonville. So I thought it was only right, since he was there in the Mahomes jersey, that I brought over Josh Wells, who just won the Super Bowl. And brought him over, from the Bucks, so that he could meet Julian and say hi.
Oh, man, can you do that for me with Patrick? Come on, man.
Oh, we might have to make some. Can you make some calls? It's not me anymore. It's you.
Yeah, Patrick, he's a nice guy, man. He's actually a really good dude. He probably would do it.
He probably would.
That would be incredible, guys.
Joseph, let me ask you this. Can you watch a fight as a fan and not watch it to try to pick up to improve your game?
Absolutely. Yeah, I watch fights all the time. I'm actually one of the biggest fight fans around. I saw Chase Hooper yesterday, who fights on Saturday, and I had to hold myself back from fangirling over him. But I was just like, oh, you're Chase Hooper. And he's like, yeah. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. And then I saw Holly Holm as well. And then all I could do is just like have a big cheesy smile, and we made eye contact, and she's like, hey guys, how are you doing? And I'm just like, oh my God.
So since you're as big a fan as it sounds, that you are, where are you going to display the fight poster that every fighter gets? Where is that going to be in your home?
It won't be, man. I actually sell them. I actually send out care packages on my gaming channel. I have a video gaming channel on Facebook. At Ugly Man Joe Gaming, and I do raffles, man, for all my gear that I have, and I raffle them all off just to help build my channel up and build my name up, and so I'll most likely end up raffling that one off with the fight gloves that I have as soon as this fight's over.
Very cool. I see Matt giving a look. I already know what the look means. I'll send him a poster or something that I have in storage.
Well, no, I thought you were going somewhere different, that you were asking about being a big fight fan, and obviously he knew his name's Hooper. You called him Hopper.
For sure.
Twice you called him.
Once. It was once. I did it once.
So at least he knows his name.
Exactly. Joe, what can the fans expect to see when you get in the octagon on Saturday?
Well, me and my opponent both have 100% finish rate, so guaranteed a banger. I've been training extremely hard on my cardio since my last fight. I took a loss to a decision with a really skilled Jamie Pickett. So I'm planning on going three rounds. Wish it was five. But it's definitely going to be a banger. It's going to be an all-out bloodbath for sure, especially if he can take a punch because he's coming off a knockout. So I imagine he's been working hard, reserving his chin for just for this fight. So definitely going to be a type of fight where you don't want to blink while you're watching. And I'm looking for a performance bonus off of this as well. So I'm looking to go all out from the moment that bell rings.
Why would you want this to be a five-rounder? Because then it would be a main event, because you might get paid a little more, or just because you are insane?
Show off that cardio.
I guess a little insanity is involved, but also, I mean, I'm really fresh to the UFC, man. And I don't know if you know, but it's really nerve-wracking being on the stage you've dreamt about being of from the moment you've started training. But the more time I can spend in that cage, the more used to it, I guess you could say, I would get. So I just want to be in there as long as possible, being dominant, you know, from the start to finish, and just really just get myself and become who I'm meant to be in there. So that's going to take time.
Sure. Very good stuff. Well, we appreciate your time. I know that we have your address. We're going to send you a care package from Ape Man Strong, as well as a box of really cool socks from Odd Sock Official. Enjoy the week. Enjoy the process. And have a good time on graduation on Saturday when you get back in into the cage.
Heck yeah, man. Thanks so much, guys. Appreciate it.
All right, take care. Joseph Holmes back at it, UFC Fight Night 206. Let's hit a quick break and then run the rest of the show with Ron still hanging out. That's going to be awesome.
You got it.
A lot of cool stuff. This is Knockout Radio, brought to you by 8 Man Strong and Staff Sock. We'll be right back.
It's the MIBs. Here come the MIBs.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
Hi, this is Cal Ripken Jr., and you're listening to Talking Sports with Randy Harris.
8 Man Strong is not simply about the biggest or strongest. It's about those who have survived true lows, suffered, faced demons real or in their heads, and are fighting to come back against it all. If you live with a passion for greatness and strength and resilience towards all obstacles that may attempt to derail you, if you're bold and aggressive in the pursuit of the things you want in life, if you are meant to overcome everything that stands in your path of reaching your goals, then you are 8 Man Strong.
Friday, May 20th, Eagle FC returns with some of the biggest names in MMA. Heavyweights clash in the main event as Junior Dos Santos is back.
Oh, my goodness!
He'll take on hard-hitting Jorgen De Castro, plus Thiago Silva takes on Hector Lombard. Watch live and free. Sign up today at EagleFC.com. Eagle FC 47. The legend is back. Junior Dos Santos versus Jorgen De Castro. Friday, May 20th at 6 p.m. Eastern.
Ooh, give me more!
This is Randy Harris for Mick for Hair at Gottsplit End Salon in Pinellas Park, our official hair care and grooming provider who caters to everyone, women, men, kids, and senior citizens in an affordable, upscale environment staffed with the most talented professionals in the business. Visit Mick for Hair at Gottsplit Ends today at 4376 Park Boulevard in Pinellas Park or call him at 727-290-9873.
How would you like to be like Jorge Masvidal, Dustin Poirier, Daniel Cormier, Joe Rogan, me, and many, many others? You could also own an amazing painting from Ross Baines Art. Ross paints original canvas art, including custom commission work. There is nothing Ross Baines can't paint. Ross was commissioned to paint the Masvidal flying knee mural on the ATT gym wall as well. Hang a painting in your house or office of your favorite athlete, actor, pet, family, sunset, you get the idea. Check out his amazing talent on the online store at rossbainesart.bigcartel.com and join the Ross Baines Art owner family. Follow Ross today on Twitter at Ross Baines Art.
Calling all Rocky Balboa fans, check out the sock collection available at oddsocksofficial.com. If you're a Breaking Bad fan or WWE or South Park, check out the sock collection available at oddsocksofficial.com. Scarface, Godfather, Back to the Future, and Jaws, and many others available at oddsocksofficial.com. Double Dare, SpongeBob, Street Fighter, and did I mention Rocky Balboa? All available at oddsocksofficial.com. That's odd, S-O-X, official.com. If you can't find a pair to wear, then why do you have feet?
Does your garage door opener seem to have a mind of its own? Or is it a squeaky or noisy garage doors? Sounds like they need a simple tune-up. Call Moores Boulevard Garage Doors. That's M-O-R-S-E Boulevard Garage Doors at 727-522-5070. I'm so glad I did, and they fixed my garage door correctly on the very first visit. Moores Boulevard Garage Doors offers 24/7 service and no extra charge for nights or weekend emergency calls. Repair or replace your garage door with Moores Boulevard Garage Doors. Call them today at 727-522-5070.
Got bills? Looking for work, but nobody is hiring? StaffZone is. As the leading provider of commercial construction, industrial, and special event staffing throughout the Southeast and Texas, StaffZone has plenty of work to go around, and they need you now. Don't wait. Go now to www.thestaffzone.com and find a branch closest to you. Work today, get paid today. That's the StaffZone way.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
This is Powerful Pound, the best fighter in the world, Floyd Mayweather, and you're talking sports with Randy, the best in the world, Harris.
Thanks, Floyd. I appreciate that, Floyd Mayweather. So here's the deal real quick about the co-host. So there's now four co's on Matt. Matt can be a total tool for 1 hour and 57 minutes and 30 seconds. And then he says, one, it's like golf. You can play crap
that
golf.
One shot brings you back the next
on the 18th. Isn't it always on the 18th?
I'm always clutch.
It's not on the third hole. It's the 18th.
He's always clutch, he says.
I'm clutch.
You're also very humble. Your humility is very attractive.
Well, I have pants on, so it's easier to be humble with.
Wow.
All right, so I got a text message. I'm supposed to ask you how you died on General Hospital.
How I died. You want the PC answer or the real answer?
Well, I'd rather stay on the air. So.
Oh, okay. I took a bunch of people hostage. I was a cop. I played you know who Serpico was?
Yeah.
They based my character.
I didn't see the movie, but yeah, I know who it is.
Well, they based my character on Serpico. I was a good cop for 2.5 years, and then finally it was time to leave the show, and I ended up like beating up these people, these strippers, and taking them hostage. I took everybody hostage for like 11 episodes, and then I had a gunfight with technically the guy who actually took my job, funny enough, and he shot me. I was like, well, that's you know, in the stars. So I got shot, but apparently as they zipped up the body bag, I blinked because I was like, it was like weird. And they were like, he blinked. All the fans were like,
he's coming back.
He's not dead. So that's what happened.
Well, thank you for the segue. So I wanted to ask you, Caleb, and we can talk, you know, about actors as well. You know, it's come out like in Tennessee, you know, where the quarterback said, I'm not here to help the rookie take my job.
Yeah.
You just said this is a guy that's eventually taking your job. And I remember in the locker room talking to you guys, you know, that you're a close-knit, blah, blah, blah. But you know, the guy at the locker room next to you is trying to take your job.
100%. And we, like, it's a weird dynamic because you understand very well every year you get older that at some point they're going to draft somebody in your position and he's coming for your job. But I, when I got to Tampa Bay, I had really great veterans who took me under their wing and taught me everything. And one day I asked them, Evan Smith and DeMar Dotson. And I asked him, I was like, hey, like, you guys have been, like, I didn't think you guys would be this nice. Like, they drafted me and, like, blah, blah, blah. He was like, well, hey, man, like, if I get hurt, you have to play. He's like, I don't want to win games. So he's like, I want you to be the best you can be. I want you to be better. But on the flip side, I understand where Ryan Tannehill was coming from, where as offensive line, we're very dependent on each other. Five guys are playing. We need to work as one. Quarterback, it's a little different. A little bit more ego, a little bit more divish.
That's why Matt wants to be the quarterback.
He's making $30-some million a year, and they draft a guy in the second round. He's like, I'm not giving up making $30 million. So I see both sides.
And Malik is very different quarterback than him, too, right?
Exactly.
So opposite. It's really interesting. I thought Tomlin was going to take him.
Yeah.
That was pretty.
You know, he loses his biggest weapon, right? He loses his biggest weapon, and they draft a running quarterback. So now what's the best aspect of the game? It's the run game. Derrick Henry, Malik. They have a really good dynamic backfield as far as running the ball goes and not so much down the field with the air ball. So I understand the insecurities he's feeling, and I honestly had no problem with it. You know, it's not his job
right.
to coach anybody up. And if somebody does take under the wing, it's an honor. but it's not there. It's not required.
So give me your side of an actor. You said here's a guy that was basically coming for your job.
Well, specifically in that situation was there was another soap opera called One Life to Live, and it went off the air as I was on the show. And there was this wonderful actor, Michael Easton, who he was playing a cop on this other show, and the executive producer had come over just before he did. And basically, you know, it's corporate, man. I understand. Sure. But it's okay. It's a little different, I think, for us, because when you're an athlete, like, you don't have a long time as it is. I mean, most people last 2-4 years, maybe, whatever. As an actor, you try to get another shot. So it's not exactly the same. He didn't come in going, I'm going to act better than you. You know, it was like that. I just knew that we both couldn't play the same role, and it was cool, you know.
How difficult was it to play a dead body?
Well, have you seen my acting? It's pretty. That's how I mostly come across.
Because that's I watch Friends a lot, you know. And Joey, you know, was always playing dead bodies.
Joey Tribbiani set my people back 50 years. He's going. I hate that. I hate it. He made the Italian people look stupid. So forget it. I don't watch that show.
Hey, oh, who's the comedian?
He's Sebastian.
I saw him at the Strass a couple years ago.
Sebastian, he's funny.
Yeah, he's hilarious.
He's
man.
Funny. Yeah, and he's very, and most of that is very accurate.
Yeah, you know? he's awesome.
So
yeah.
I'm surprised that I've taken an hour and 45 minutes to bring up that you have acted with Adrian.
Yeah, Talia Shire. Yeah.
Well, Adrian to me.
Okay, Adrian. So yeah, she is amazing. You know, it was really interesting. I was on set with her. I got cast to play her son, and we, you know, had 50.
Would that be Rocky Jr.?
No. You know, she did other movies.
Oh, okay.
It was actually, you know, it's funny, it was called Pizza with Bullets, and she was my mother, and Vinny Pastore, who played Big Puss on The Sopranos, he was my dad, and so we had this, we had so many scenes together, and it was amazing, and she became a real friend. I mean, I've spent time at her house, and she's made me dinner. I just went over, just her and I, talking all night, and she's a very special person.
Did you go to her gravesite?
I did go to her gravesite.
Yeah, you went to her gravesite.
Did you know that she has a gravesite in Philadelphia?
No, because she's alive.
Right. Well, you know, no, Adrian's not.
I was so confused just now. I know she passed away in the movie.
No. There is a gravesite for Adrian and Paulie in Philadelphia.
Is it,
you know,
really?
Yeah, it was part of one of the scenes, and we went, you know, to the cemetery.
And they kept it there?
And it's a creepy. Yeah.
I just directed a movie called Mob Sense in Philadelphia last year, so it's coming together now. And we shot at the Rocky statue. We did all the Philadelphia stuff in the movie. So.
Right, that movie I'll go watch because it's all Philadelphia related.
Yeah, it's really, it used to be called Brotherly Love, but they changed it to Mob Sense. So, and I directed it, and I've got a part. I've very funny character. I play this gangster who's actually gay, and he comes out to his brother, and they're going to kill him. And he's like, don't tell anybody. We're going to get whacked, you know? And he's just hardcore. It's very funny, beautiful stories.
You know, we always do, like, Mount Rushmores of athletes, Mount Rushmores of this and that. Give me your Mount Rushmores of your jobs, of, you know.
Acting.
Yeah,
or producing. Or
well, I think my biggest one is turned out to be like a dad to me. It's Joe Mantegna. He's my, you know, he's to me, he's like on top of the hill for me. And personally, professionally, everything. So Joe, but, you know, obviously I grew up loving De Niro and Pacino. Those guys were my idols. And I remember as a kid, I don't know if you remember the great independent film, The Pope of Greenwich Village. It was Mickey Rourke, Eric Roberts, back in the 80s. One of the best films, you should see it. It's when Mickey Rourke still had his face. I don't know what happened.
Should surprise you not that I haven't seen it?
Yeah, it's really, you know, your credibility is, I mean, I hate to say that. Matt has a little more.
Oh, wow.
It's not just here, my friend. It's been suspect all over his career.
No, it seems to be. I'm getting nervous. I think I overstayed my welcome.
While you guys were talking about the people that were replacing
so it's
you,
Matt.
While you're talking about job replacements and people trying to take your jobs and, like, not coaching your replacements, I always take a photograph.
Yeah, I've watched.
Of how to, like, hook this board up so that way I can run this show. And when Randy moves aside.
Wow, you know? So that's happening even here in the room.
Yeah, I watched him as he's doing it. I'm like, what are you doing?
Adrian, Paulie, and Randy.
You know what? Not to get too sappy, but I really believe on a spiritual note, everybody's going to get what they have coming to them. So if this is supposed to be yours, it's yours. Work hard. Do your best. You put, you know what I mean? And then what's yours is yours. And what's not.
So are you addressing that to me or to Matt? Because Matt doesn't do his best on this show.
I got a MacBook.
I'm trying to make you feel better when Matt takes the job. Oh. I'm trying to give you a little spiritual advice.
Is that what it is? All right, let's go hit our final break of the afternoon. Coming to you live from Tournament de Pizza. This is Knockout Radio, brought to you by 8 Man Strong and Staff Zone. We'll be right back.
Fireball.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
Hi, this is Steve Smith, Giants wide receiver, and you're talking sports with Randy Harris.
8-Man Strong is not simply about the biggest or strongest. It's about those who have survived true lows, suffered, faced demons real or in their heads, and are fighting to come back against it all. If you live with a passion for greatness and strength and resilience towards all obstacles that may attempt to derail you, if you're bold and aggressive in the pursuit of the things you want in life, if you are meant to overcome everything that stands in your path of reaching your goals, then you are 8-Man Strong.
Country Depot, located at 36 North Broad Street in historic downtown Brooksville, could be the coolest store on planet Earth. From home and garden decor, handbags, and sports items, Country Depot carries a very large variety of unique gifts like nautical, primitive, country, and much more. Follow them on Facebook at Country Depot and stay tuned to Knockout Radio for details on how to register to win a $50 gift certificate. It's called Country Depot in Brooksville and worth the drive.
Construction companies always face hiring challenges. Do you need temporary help on your project? Or maybe you want a true partner for all of your staffing needs? Staff Zone is construction staffing excellence, providing both skilled and general labor positions. And we want to work for you. For all of your construction staffing needs, call us at 877-247-ZONE or visit us online at thestaffzone.com to find your local branch. Our staffing professionals are eager and ready to earn your business. That's 877-247-ZONE.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
This is D'Lo Brown from NWA TNN. Right here, right now, you're listening to Talking Sports with Randy Harris.
Yeah, all right, we are back coming to you live. We won't talk about the movie, but yeah, there was some real stuff that happened in that movie that wasn't movie related.
Yeah, with Jamie Foxx and the...
Yeah. And what, LL Cool J?
LL Cool J.
Yeah, uh-huh. It was those two. So, Ronnie, final couple minutes. We got about 8 minutes or so. So, let's bring it back Saturday, back on stage at the Straz. Yeah. Talk to us a little bit about the man, Lenny Bruce.
Yeah, Lenny was, he died in the 60s. He was a comic. He died in 66. He was a forward thinker. He was the first comic to get on stage and not do jokes. He always said his comedy was very much like Charlie Parker. He had a jazz rhythm. He heard it like jazz music. And because he would play in these dive bars in front of this jazz band, and he'd turn around and make the band laugh. He was the first guy to say, "So listen to what happened to my wife." Nobody was doing that kind of comedy. They're like, "What? Now that's all we know." Right. But like, he paved the way and like held a mirror up to society and asked a lot of questions. Yeah, but why? But why? But why? You know, and they didn't like that. And so, the play is tragic. And it's very funny, and it's everything. You go on a ride, you watch. People don't realize how important he was, and still is. I mean, they still teach about him in college and First Amendment free speech. And, he was not just the comic. But he was obviously, the godfather of comedy, in my opinion. And many's. If you hear interviews about, Richard Pryor and Carlin, they say without Lenny, they just don't exist,
Well, and the younger generation, all they normally hear is, without Carlin, without Richard Pryor, they don't go that far back to Lenny Bruce. They go to that era.
Well, the good news is there's a show called The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. It's on Amazon, and they have a Lenny Bruce character. And he's Lenny Bruce, and he comes, he saves the day for the lead character, and he's a comic. So there's an entire generation of people who now are hip to who Lenny was, at least a version of Lenny. They don't tell the whole story, warts and all, but they introduced him. Because when I wrote the play, I thought it was for 90-year-old little Jewish ladies. That's why I thought I was writing the play for.
My mom's not quite that old. She's about 78.
She would know Lenny. She probably. It turns out I wrote the play for everybody because 70% of my audience is young people now because of Maisel. They're like, "Oh, I want to learn more about this guy." And the fact that places like the Straz are calling for me to do it tells me that there's something here.
What's it like to tour? You know, you talked about you were in one place up in New York, you were in one place in California. What is it about touring, you know, that you enjoy, or do you even enjoy doing that?
I do now. You know, I was commuting every weekend to Chicago. I have a 14-year-old daughter, and it was awful not being with her. So, but my fiance comes with me everywhere I go. You see my big entourage here, Janelle and Courtney. That's my whole crew. And Courtney handles the stage managing. And we just, you know, we travel around. We have fun. I try not to do consecutive cities to the best of my ability. I try to do a city, go home for a little bit, do another city, because I try to kind of control how much I'm out. But
Do you, and I know you try to get out into St. Pete a little bit, do you try to go and experience, see things, do things, you know, when you have time?
I try, but, you know, St. Pete, we couldn't wait to get here today, and it was...
But now you can't wait to leave.
It was pouring so hard. We didn't even get out of the car. We sat in the car. There was, like, buckets of rain on top of the car.
For, like, 10 minutes, and then nothing.
Yeah, well, it was a lot. I was sitting in the car the whole time. Anyway, but apparently that's common here. There's a lot of, like... But St. Pete is awesome, and I really want to go to Steinbrenner Field.
I'm going to call a friend of mine who's heavily involved, high up the food chain.
I work Saturday, and then we
don't let work get in the way of a good time, though.
But we don't leave till Wednesday is what I'm saying to you.
Okay.
So I'm around Sunday, Monday, Tuesday.
I have a question before we have run out of time. You know, when you get into a character, and you said you had to really dive into, like, get into the character. You know, is there a bit of a point where you played a role where you're like, you know what? This is how people know me. This is I like this identity better than, like, my own identity. Or have you ever, like, seen yourself?
And can you teach him? Because we got to get rid of the identity that he has.
Or playing a police officer on General Hospital. Have you ever, you know, like, told people not jaywalk when you see him in public?
No, but the opposite. People ask me for police advice, and I'm like, I'm an actor. I don't even know what I'm talking about. I say, I'm learning lines and regurgitating. They're like, what should I do about this? I go, call the cops. So no, but the Lenny Bruce character.
Thank God you're not a doctor.
I have played a doctor, and I have gotten those questions. But, Lenny Bruce was like the ultimate hipster, baby. You know, this is how I do the show, man. He was like a groovy cat, you know. So it's not like me, you know. But I guess there's a part of me that kind of, you know, we've become, you know, we're in a relationship. But no, ultimately, I'm pretty happy with myself. I'm like you, Matt. I really do have high self-esteem. I'm very proud of myself. So, you know.
Bravo.
Do you get to, like, sporting events when you're on the road? Like, well, the Rays are in town, so.
I always try. The Yankees are coming next week. I'm so upset.
Well, they have planes back.
Yeah. Yeah, but I, you know, it's a lot. It's just a lot.
Did the Rays get rained out today?
I don't know.
I go to a lot of sporting events. I love it. You know, my friend has season tickets to the Kings. You know, I grew up in New York, so I'm a Ranger fan, but we have Kings tickets, you know. And obviously, I can't wait till football comes back. I mean, it's my favorite, of course. I love baseball. I watch the Yankees every single day from 4 p.m. to like 7 L.A. time. So no matter what I'm doing, I go home and watch the game. And so I'm a big sports fan. You know?
Now, speaking of the Yankees, that shirt behind you is the minor league team for the Yankees. That was like when there's only three boroughs, and that's a framed jersey.
My friend brought me – that's awesome. My friend brought me a hat called the Tampa Bay Yankees, T.Y.
And yeah, T.Y. Yeah.
I wear it a lot. My friend – everyone's like, what is that? Ty? Who's Ty?
Well, it was supposed to say T.B., but they got those hats in China. And
yeah, well, they got a good deal on them. That's
a true story. I went and I wanted to buy hilarious. A Washington Redskin hat, you know, when they were taking the Redskin name off. And I bought one on Amazon, and it was from China, and it was like a TT shot hat instead. It was just a total, but it was supposed to be the Yankee.
Everybody's offended now.
What do you collect? No. Do you collect anything memorabilia-wise, sports memorabilia, any of that kind of stuff?
Yes. If you'd like to talk to my fiance about this, she's right here. My kitchen has two big glass towers of all Yankee memorabilia, and I've got some really good stuff. Bucky Dent, Jeter, you know, great Mickey Mantle, stuff like that. So I do.
Randy asks a question usually on the show. I'm surprised he hasn't asked you yet. If you could have dinner with four people, dead or alive, fictional or not, who would they be?
Can't be family. Because obviously you would be.
Yeah, yeah. Definitely Lenny Bruce.
Yeah.
Definitely. I think, wow, that's intense.
Yeah.
That's intense, uh-huh. Right? Dead or alive?
Dead or alive.
Fictional or not?
Derek Jeter. I'd like to hang out with Jeter. I'd say maybe, I think this could sound crazy, Rocky Blyer, Steelers running back
sure,
in the 70s.
He veteran. Vietnam, veteran, yeah.
I love Rocky
Great
Blyer.
Story.
Yeah, yeah. I always looked up to Rocky Blyer. And who else? It can't be my fiance?
Well, no, because she would be considered as family.
I would say James Dean.
Oh.
James Dean.
That's a
great, did you say that?
That's a great answer.
She's right. I got pictures of him all over my house. So. Well,
there you go. There you go.
She's been trying to take him down.
If you could acquire one piece of memorabilia of anything, of absolutely anything, what would that be?
Spot. It's tough.
That's tough because one of it.
The best answer ever.
Well, I want to hear the answer first.
Eliminate it. All right. Not gonna
guess. So a good friend of ours, Leonard Wester. We only have a minute left. I asked, he goes, I don't want anything. I don't collect anything. I'm like, Leonard, you have to say something. He's real religious, and he's going through religious school, whatever it's called. I don't know. And he goes, Jesus Christ sandals.
Obviously,
it's hard to top that.
I can't do better.
Yeah, you can't. That's why I didn't want to say it. I want those sandals. I want to walk a mile in those shoes.
They'd go for a lot of money.
Yeah, you think?
I've been doing his show for a while during when I was playing with the Bucks. And he'd ask me that question, and I'd answered it, you know, and I'd give him my answer. And then he told me Leonard's answer. One time I was like, yeah, come on.
You can't tell me.
My answer's stupid, right?
A Derek Jeter double.
Yeah. I got a couple things in my mind, but they're
Do you know that you can now buy every baseball that's being used in a game? Every single ball is for sale. Yeah. And I'll show you the website. Like, I'm on it with the Rays and the Phillies. You know, this pitch was a strike to whoever. This was a double to left field.
I hope they're doing something with the money.
But yeah, it's going to the MLBs. Yeah. All right, we are out of time. Ronnie, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Hopefully we can stay, you know, connected. We can do some stuff in the future.
Actually, I was going to ask you to lose my phone number because this is not going well.
Well, as long as you're not telling me to get rid of Twitter, we're okay because that's how we've been communicating.
That's true.
Saturday, what time are the two shows?
2:30 and 7:30.
So if I'm going, it better be the 2:30 so I can be in bed by 4, right?
And if anybody's interested, go to LennyBruceOnStage.com and you'll get all the info.
Good stuff. All right, guys. Awesome. Enjoy yourself on Saturday. Enjoy the pizza, you know, whatever Matt's going to go back and throw together. I'll call Derek real quick. I'm calling Howard to get him at the stadium. This has been Knockout Radio, brought to you by 8 Man Strong and Staff Zone. See everybody next week. And I have your address.
WTAN Clearwater
FM 106.1
WDCF Dade City
FM 102.3
WZHR Zephyr Hills
FM 104.3
Listen.